This is the third video on chapter 11. This video will go over the Bohr model of the atom. So we were left with Rutherford's nuclear model of the atom. However, the nuclear model of the atom does not explain how the atom can gain or lose energy. And Niels Bohr developed a model of the atom to explain how the structure of the atom changes when it undergoes energy transitions. So Bohr's major idea was that the energy of the atom was quantized and that the amount of energy in the atom was related to the electron's position in the atom. So quantized, if you remember, means that there is only a certain level of energy that are authorized and nothing in between. So in the Bohr model, electrons travel in orbits around the nucleus at given amounts of energy. And you can imagine orbits like shells, more than planet orbits. It's not like circles. It's more like onion shell, it's a spherical envelope, if you will. And the electron roam into that spherical envelope that we call shell. And the farther the electron is from the nucleus, and the more energy it has. And so those shells are given a symbol N to be identified, and so the first shell around the nucleus is identified by n equal 1, the second shell is n equal 2, the third is n equal 3, etc. And the farther you go away from the nucleus, and the higher the amount of energy in the shells. So in the Bohr model of the hydrogen atom, the lowest amount of energy the hydrogen's one electron can have corresponds to being in the n equal 1 orbit. And we call this its ground state. So in the schematic here, we have energy going up. N equal 1 represents the ground state. That's the first shell after the nucleus. When the atom gains energy, the electron leaps to a higher energy orbit, and we call this an excited state. So in the schematic here, n equal 2 represents the first excited state, but there are many other excited states above it, symbolized by n equal 3, n equal 4, etc. And so the atom is less stable in an excited state. And so it will release the extra energy to return to the ground state. So the red wavy lines here are representing the electron when it's releasing the energy and going back to the ground state from excited state N2. And you can see that a photon is emitted, or the energy is released in the shape of a photon of a specific color, for example, red. But if the electron was in the excited state that is above, like n equals 3, and it goes down to n equal 1, then the amount of energy that is released is different. And so it will have a different color if it's emitted as light. But when an electron is in a higher excited state, it can go down to another excited state, not necessarily always down to the ground state. So atoms can give off light, and that's how they will release the energy that they acquired or absorbed earlier. So first, they must receive energy from the outside and become excited. The energy is then released in the form of a photon. And a photon, we know, is the way we call light when we give it a particle, the shape of a particle. The energy of the photon corresponds exactly to the energy change experienced by the emitting atom. So the schematic here is for a lithium atom. when energy, external energy is provided to the lithium atom, it moves up into an excited state. And that's an unstable state when atoms are in the excited state. And so it will release the energy and then go back to a lower energy state. And the energy is released in the form of a photon of red light in the case of lithium, because lithium, as you can see from the picture here, when you burn a salt of lithium, the flame is red. So lithium is emitting red light. In the case of hydrogen, we have found that now hydrogen has four excited states above its ground state. And so if you recall the line spectrum of hydrogen, there was only four wavelengths represented there that are emitted by hydrogen with very specific wavelengths. And for a specific wavelength, we have a specific and given energy, right? And that amount of energy corresponds exactly to gaps between excited states and the ground state, or between two different excited states. So for example, it's not necessarily true, but the wavelength of 486 nanometers, the green light emitted by hydrogen, could be due to the electron going down from excited state n equal 5 to excited state n equal 2. And the blue light could be from n equal 4 to n equal 2, etc. So those gaps of energy are exact. It's an exact amount, and that's why there is only an emission of wavelengths at a particular value. And so many atoms are like that, you know, giving off colors when you burn them, if they are in a solution. Mostly metals are giving off colors like that. On the left here, we see a picture of NaCl being burned, and it gives off a very intense yellow light. That's identifying sodium here. The picture of the middle here shows when we are burning a solution of copper chloride, you see some green and some blue, and that's due to the copper, and the blue also to the chloride when it's bonded to the copper. And then the magnesium here on the bottom right corner gives off a very intense white light that you should never look at directly, because it's also containing UV light that is very harmful to your eyes. But these properties of metals are used to make fireworks. And so people who are manufacturing fireworks are putting together mixtures of compounds, or it's just compounds by themselves, if you want the color by itself. And typically, for example, if you want a firework with a red color, it's going to be a powder of lithium or a compound of strontium. Orange is obtained by using calcium, yellow by using sodium. Yellow-green colors are used by are obtained by using boron compounds. Green from barium and copper, blue from copper, and the copper halides. So when copper is bonded to an halogen, you get blue. Purple or violet is obtained with potassium compound. And white or silver colors are due to aluminum, magnesium, or titanium. So the Bohr model of the atom is a success, but only a partial success, because the mathematics of the Bohr model very accurately predicts the spectrum of hydrogen, but it only works for hydrogen. its mathematics fails when applied to multi-electron atoms. It cannot account for electron-electron interactions. So a better model was needed, and scientists developed the quantum mechanical model. And so you can watch these videos of the birth of the quantum mechanical model or quantum mechanics of an electron on your own after this video.